programme, however, seems to be able to put a process in place where it does actually deal with that. It brings the two parties together on a voluntary basis, and there's some really good success stories there. The police are using it as a tactic themselves, and also we're looking to roll it out into schools and such like as well for some of their behaviour. So I think there's some real promising work there. The third of the four priority areas, if you like, through the pledge, is in paragraph 3.18, or starts there, and this is about protecting vulnerable people in our society. So again, as a partnership, which is moving away from just necessarily measuring criminality and those criminal behaviours that are in there, whether they be serious or positive crime or things of that nature, the world's moved on. Some of those risks that are coming onto board now are the things that we're hearing, such as safeguarding issues, child sexual exploitation, and back to things like social isolation and what our populace doing and why do they feel unsafe. So within this protecting vulnerable people pledge, this is about bringing the agencies together so that we can tackle that issue and try and bring back some sort of community propensity to almost look after each other again and bring that back into the world. Also to use it about tackling some of those real high-risk crime, criminal behaviours, such as domestic abuse, such as harmful practices, hate crime, and things of that nature. So there's a pledge around protecting vulnerable people there, which the partnership is very keen to tackle. The one thing I wanted to say as well around that protecting vulnerable people and around the ASP, and throughout this whole pledge, and also the domestic abuse pledge, is the shift to having children centric in all of our approach towards this. Because ultimately, if we don't start with behaviour change and prevention, then we'll never have the resources to be able to tackle in a response situation the things that are going on. So people who've heard me through that domestic abuse committee that I've chaired, etc., have very much seen me pushing towards that. And I know members around this committee have been very supportive in that, but that's what we need to look at, how we deal with that prevention and that changing behaviours and changing cultures. The final bit is about delivering greater integration. I suppose this could be easily labelled the pounds, shillings and pence block, really, but I really don't want it to be that. I do, with an absolute passion as an officer here, believe that we can do things far greater in partnership and integrating with other services than even the good work we're doing now. And if this means us as a council standing there and saying, well, actually, we have a community control service which does a security check and all the rest of it and drives around as a single person in a van, and then we've got the police who don't allow their PCSOs to drive around, they have to catch buses and go, why don't we put in the same vehicle and then go and do the work together and things of that nature. So it really is down to that practical level that we're really looking to work in this. And it's not just the police and the council. The intention is that we, as a wider partnership that we've all signed up to, that we do try and look at opportunities where any agency, and I'm probably directing this towards the social landlords and the private security firms are out there, and that I'm sure bringing those in to part of this and be part of this delivery, that again we can see greater benefits from sharing some of that workload, or at least some strategies on how we can deliver that. So I'm very conscious of time that I've talked a bit. I put the new structure which we're proposing on the community safety partnership in paragraph 3.24 or figure 2. And again, I hope members can see there that what we've done is we've got a community or a safer world partnership board. This is what we're proposing that we'll move into for 2016, which covers the main areas of risk around community safety on Wirral. So we've got an anti-social behaviour subgroup that will be tasked with very much delivering around that. We've got a hate crime group, which at the moment the hate crime group is pretty much made up of statutory agencies talking about numbers of reports they've had through, rather than actually engaging with the whole host of voluntary and third sector groups that are out there tackling hate crime in a real context. So it's about bringing those on board and helping those, and actually asking them to need more to assist that. There's a whole bit about reducing reoffending. Again, I talk about this behaviour and culture change, working with our colleagues in the integrated offender management team, so that's police, community rehabilitation company, and the National Probation Service. This is dealing with our high-risk offenders, and we're really having some impacts there. We've changed their workload this year round to actually one of the cohorts they're managing is that high-risk domestic abuse perpetrators. So there's 16 or 17 high-risk domestic abuse measured by the National Probation Service, probably come out of prison, and they're getting intensive monitoring to ensure they don't re-offend, and if they do, they're banned up straight away. So again, it's about bringing those changes in terms of their behaviour. We've got a domestic abuse and harmful practices group, which I mentioned before, and a number of process groups that sit under that. One group I am keen to bring into this world, which hasn't been before, is what's called the Widow Resilience Action Group. So this is trying to bring in the emergency planning side and give it an avenue that it can accept. We've got lots of things in place, but there's something about just making sure when people talk about business continuity, emergency planning, are those all the businesses linked in, and actually do they have a forum where they can discuss our Widow footprint? I don't think it's there at the moment, so that's the intention of that group to do that. And then the final group is one that really we're in discussions with Public Health and Fiona. There are work streams and a lot of work streams in place around drug, alcohol, harm reduction. We know we've had the citizens group that's fed back the things they want from that. So again, it's bringing that world into this that just integrates a little bit more because they've been sat out in their own silos, looking at their own different areas. And I don't say that in any critical way, it's just that's where they've been. So it's giving them an avenue. And then the whole pinkish block on the left-hand side just sort of shows that demonstrates that the CSP will link to a whole range of existing groups and forums which will take it forward. I know it's not very clear there, folks, but it is there. So very clear that we think the new structure will deliver something that gives everything a house and a place to own and sees a governance structure that goes through there, and hopefully members will reflect that actually there is ways that they can feed in if there are issues that give them concern around these that we'll have a voice to deal with. So recommendations, if I may, Chair, I'm happy to answer any questions, are that this committee note the report and the contents and understand the delivery of the two pledges and recommend to Cabinet the priorities of those pledges going forward. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thanks, Mark. Okay, we've got Matt, Christina, Adam, Gerry.
Little to disagree with in terms of this, I mean, who could, but it does not seem ambitious. I must say, like, in terms of what we're looking to do, in terms of our focus on domestic abuse, hate crime, child sexual exploitation, down terrorism, I was thinking, if you're picking targets, then you kind of have fewer to achieve them, and I just thought we've got quite a lot here. I know, I understand other money comes in from other areas and agencies. Just a general observation that it does seem. And the only other thing to note would be, I'd be interested to know the Community Safety Partnership agreed the 2014 to 2016 priorities, it's listed on page 23. I couldn't see a report back on how far we are with achieving them. I see the 15-16 targets set, but I couldn't see that how it's going to end. Is that just a projection? Have we got an up-to-date where we are now?
I'll take the second part first. Okay, so annually, we legally have to produce an annual statement around our performance for the Community Safety Partnership, and that's in production now. So that will be ready to be produced, and it will capture that. So I'll make sure that once that's done, it goes on the internet anyway, but I'll make sure it's passed back to yourselves as members so you can see that. So that's that first bit, hopefully, thanks for Patrick. The other bit I was going to say is about the widespread. I think what I've given you here is I've tried to explain the governance structure about how it works, whilst also taking the liberty to explain the programmes that are going on. Those are already in existence. It's just we need to make very much that framework. So those things that I've mentioned there, domestic abuse, hate crime, there is programmes already in place on that. My question when I spoke this world was, how visible is that to Wirral, not the council, but to Wirral, and actually what's the impact of that on our Wirral footprint? Because a number of these are delivered through the Merseyside Police Force geographical area or the Fire Service geographical area. So, and this isn't just me, this is consultation with the whole of the partnership. So it's their agreement, so I'm hoping that you won't tell them less ambitious plan, would you?
Not less ambitious, but I just think sometimes, sorry, but I mean realistic, especially with priorities, being sort of, isn't that right?
Yeah, if I may just put just one other point, I think what I've also been clear, I am being clear, because I'm, in terms of the officer who leads this, I am very much aware that it is far easier for the council and elected members to express success based against a binary or a digital figure. So if I said to you we had 7 of X and we had 8 the next year and going up was positive, you'd all say, oh, we're doing really well. But some of these areas we're talking about here, to be successful, I'm saying to you that we will have increasing figures. So for domestic violence as a prime example, yeah, there's no point in me coming to you saying we'll measure our success by reducing them, because I could just do that by cutting off the number of phone lines that people report here. So the reality's got to be that actually the ethos around some of these areas is actually we need to know what's going on, and that needs to be increasing reporting. ASB is a much better example in this context. 8 years of reducing ASB, yet my inbox is full of elected members saying to me about ASB issues going here. And when we go and report, investigate those, there's almost a, apathy is the wrong word, but there's almost a, in many cases, a loss of that individual's trust or expectation that someone's going to get done by reporting it through the normal channels. So we need to address that about what that means and how it works. Yeah.
First of all, on page 25, 3.18, I can understand what you're saying here, but I think the bit at the bottom is quite unfortunate, and I think you should put those separately.
Okay, so within this pledge, we could have broke every one of those up into a separate sentence.
No, I'm not saying.
All right, sorry.
The first part fits together, but then you talk about radicalisation to prevent vulnerable people from being drawn into terrorism. I think that is such a separate issue that you should put it separately. It almost reads like you're putting them all together and there might be some connection. And I think you're on very dangerous ground. You can all imagine where people's imagination would go on that one. And I don't think that that's helpful for anybody. Sorry, as an ethnic minority, I might be slightly touchy, but I do feel that's not really the best way of putting that. And my second question thing is, it's questions there, on your table, which you don't really understand, I'm sorry, is primary deliberate fires, are those people who set fires to claim insurance or get rid of stuff and the like, and secondly deliberate fires, just people who like setting fires, because it's fun.
Yeah, okay, what's the distinction between the two? Actually, what fire bomb you with me at that point? Secondary fires, I'm more comfortable with giving the definition for. So secondary fires are things where it's a secondary contributor to what's gone on. So if you think about a burnt out vehicle, the crime might actually be stealing the vehicle, but then it's burnt out at the end. So secondary fires are things that matter. Primary fires are where the actual crime we're looking at is the setting light of something in that way, as that deliberate act. So if that makes sense, that makes it any
clearer. No, because it's a positive crime, it's your primary deliberate fire. So that it would suggest, and I'm racking the brains of one of the police training school years ago, that would be when people set fire to things to claim the insurance, or they set fire to things because of other reasons to acquire something as a result. And if you said the stolen car, you're still an acquisitive crime. So I just wonder if that is, you know, people who like setting fires.
Yeah.
There are lots of them around.
I'm truthfully not sure the distinction between the two, but again, what I will do is I'll get a definition put out there that explains the two, the difference between the two. They're recorded slightly separately, but
yeah.
I wouldn't know what the difference is, to be fair.
I'm interested in the acquisitive crime. Could you tell me then on the target rationale and the proposed targets and the trend rejection, what does it actually mean?
Okay, so this is the old method of measuring success, and where they've got down the target rationale, what they're sort of trying to say. So we have a whole data analytical team, both ourselves and the police and the community safety partnership, that pull these things together. Some of them are based on old national indicators, and others are based on the police's recorded base. So when it talks about what the target rationale is, my understanding of that is that in terms of justifying where that target is, if there's a rationale being applied and what that is, then it's put in there as a comment for the table. So if, where it's got the average of 14, 16 and 15, 16 projection, it may be something that isn't specifically able to be measured, so they put a rationale in there to explain how they worked out that indicator.
Right.
Did you turn your mic off, please?
Right, so I want him to tell me how it works. What do those, take the first line, what do those figures mean? Because I don't understand it.
Okay, so the All Crime Within the Seven Beats initiative. Okay, so we deal with the Seven Beats initiative. Seven Beats is a geographical area based on seven walking beats that the police do. In terms of the crime that takes place there, they probably don't measure crime, or they don't measure crime down to an individual beat level, but because we have a seven beats initiative, we've had to apply a rationale there to give us an indicator, because we set up a project specifically about tackling crime over that geographical spread. In terms of what it means and in terms of the rationale behind that, I'd have to get one of the data analysis guys to come here and explain what that means. In terms of the targets, these targets that are here are pretty much owned by the Merseyside Police. Okay, so it's their data analysts who provided these targets. There's a move from Merseyside Police to move away from measuring their success in this manner. So if this committee wishes to have a performance measurement regime around these targets, I really need to take that back to the partnership and have a discussion with Merseyside Police about whether that's what they want to do. That I'm not saying that I can't do that, but I'm not. Is that the question?
That was my suggestion. Oh, sorry. As a council, we've got a target.
Yes.
So our part of it, I know it's implemented through a bigger organisation, but our part of it must have performance targets, like the rest of the next agenda writing, various things. And honestly, if our scrutiny committee is meant to be scrutinising this aspect, council's performance, we haven't currently got anything that we look at on a regular basis throughout the year, as we will look at other targets for this directory. So I'm just wondering whether there's a plan to have something, not for the police's targets,
no,
but something what we're all want to achieve from the partnership.
Oh, sorry, I'm sorry. Yes, there will be. There's a performance management framework going to be attached to 2020 pledges.
Okay.
So within that will come. That will come to here, and you'll be able to measure the success against that.
That's
but it won't just be statistical data.
No, that's fine. Just so there's some.
Yeah, sorry, there will be.
Just the Merseyside questions.
Oh, yes, sorry, yes. Absolutely, when I talked about integration, and I've talked about integration primarily on wheel footprint, that's because we've got the ability to do that now. The Police and Crime Commission is looking at Wirral as piloting a number of those schemes to see if there's opportunities to spread that more over the city region footprint. And certainly in the world of protecting vulnerable people, there is certainly multi-agency programs out there about having a city region strategic board and things of that nature to allow work programs to be delivered on that footprint.
Gerry?
Well, thanks, Janette. Well, thanks for the excellent questions from Matthew and others. They've more or less answered what I was going to ask you myself. But I would just have to say, I think you're doing a fantastic job, Mark.
Yes.
And the view of this and the other areas that you cover. And I would love to thank you for that. So the only remaining bit I had left for my question, and thank you all for answering, asking. How do we compare with other parts of the South? That's not really mentioned in any detail here, is it? Do you know, can you tell us?
Yes, again through you, Chair. We do measure ourselves against other areas. Primarily we measure ourselves BCU area to BCU area. That's pretty much how the measurements are undertaken.
What's a BCU?
A basic command unit, so the world command unit. But the police are restructuring the way they deliver their structures, I'm sure you're aware of. So we have a Merseyside community safety partnerships meeting, which is organised and managed by the Police and Crime Commissioner, and they undertake measurements across the city region to see where there is massive differences in terms of reported and actions to address that crime.
So what's the answer?
Yeah, so we measure favourably in terms of crime. We measure favourably. We have some things which we have far more reported accounts of, which I can provide a list of, which actually they indicate probably that actually we might have more effective systems in place rather than. So again, domestic violence is a good example of that. We have far more reports of domestic abuse and domestic violence on rural reports made, both to the police and to other agencies, than any of the other districts on those side. But I think that's because we've got excellent teams in place who actually have, and the third sector side, so tomorrow's going to be groups of that nature. So I think we compare favourably. In terms of those lists of the overview that Councillor Sykes was talking about before, I think when we talk about that performance measurement moving forward, I think it would help this committee to see some of those, even if they're cherry-picked ones that come out, that we can say we compare well here or poorly there. Okay. And thank you for the compliment.
I'd just like to add to that, Mark, I do think you're doing a fantastic job. I was involved on the rest of the day as a champion, as a domestic abuser. The work they do is absolutely fantastic, and they work with young children who have been in domestic crime situation, and also the perpetrators as well. Victims can't praise them highly enough, and I think that our focus on prevention, early intervention and prevention is much relevant, because that's where the work needs to be done. So I'd like to add my praise. Thank you for those reports.
Thanks, Chair. Can I just leave the committee as well, and Chair, through you, that if there are concerns or questions around any community safety matter, and you're not happy, because I think I speak on behalf of my colleagues in the police force, fire, we're all trying to engage with as many people as we can about this, and if you're not happy with the response that you get, certainly superintendent or temporary superintendent Hayes, who's took over or taking over from John Martin in terms of a structural command here for the time being, She's absolutely on a par with this, as is the fire service in terms of being there to answer any of those questions. What we need to do is ramp up that third sector involvement.
I think there's one more question actually before we go.
And Mark, I'd just like to say thanks for the report as well. Very informative. I've been campaigning for ever and a day to try and get prevention and early intervention as part of our strategy throughout, you know, domestic abuse, and so it's great to see that that's there. I also wanted to mention that within the Housing Association world, which I'm also involved in, that we've used the restorative justice on several occasions, and it's been really, really effective. So I do think that that is a way forward, and I think the idea of using that in schools is a really good idea to see how their behaviour is impacting on others. You did mention about the social landlord's involvement. I think think one of the things you need to bear in mind is the rent freeze that they've had, and they're also looking to cut costs. That's not to say that there isn't something that can be done, but I think we need to probably let them know sooner rather than later before they go into their budgeting for the year of what we might expect from them.
Okay, through you, Chair. Absolutely. Again, just so this committee is only aware, one of our largest social landlords announced to me 6 months ago that they were withdrawing £180,000 worth of support from a contract which supported our community patrol service. So I'm very much well aware and I understand the difficult decisions that they've got to take. My issue is that when they undertook any housing association, whether it be private landlords and their other masters, particularly poor social landlords, when they take decisions that withdraw neighbourhood or community services in their areas, they need to take those with the understanding that there is, may not be the full support there elsewhere that's been in the past to come deal with those matters, and that's why we're very much engaged in having those conversations about you might need to take them all in isolation, why don't you come and almost join the party and be part of that solution, and we can help you, you can help us.
Okay, which one? Open that to the recommendations. Thank you. Okay, so the next item on the agenda is Tom going to present this report. What is the Directorate of Planning
for the report? This is the regular update that comes up in the performance report. Highlighted the report, essentially, the notary this performance at the end of December. That's the headline. It's set out in the section 3 there. Of the 19 indicators at this stage, 5 reported as red. There's probably a lot of commonality there, or lots of reported red throughout the year. I'm sure everybody has some comments on. The first one is the source of performance appraisals. That's the thing. I wasn't present at the last week, so I don't think we had a good session discussing performance appraisals. So, in terms of how we take our full capacity and update, the Chief Executive Leadership Team are looking to issue some accountability statements for senior officers from every year. Part of that will include responsibility. And staff management, which includes appraisal. So that's strengthening the desire to get these done, because there still is our leadership team to get appraisal to the cost of the workforce. We're looking to tackle those that are moving in, tackle the strong differences. So there's sickness absence, staff continue to increase, unfortunately. Again, it's the impact of change of policy introduced last year, further changes in the managers and seniors that are having to tackle absence. In terms of is it working, it's difficult to say in terms of is it working, the sickness is decreasing, so we can find it doesn't, but it's the nature of the sickness that needs to address. In terms of the shorter absences, I understand they're going now, I noticed that the longer absences are increasing. Picking through a couple of the other headlines there, finance is one that's highlighted on page 34. Since the end of December, it has improved. Additional staff have been put in the support the personal finance unit team, so it's closer towards the target that it was then. In terms of the discharge of debt, this is 12 members, come the end of the financial year, but it's important to go to the cabinet, normally June time, which is the collection performance for the year, and that will include a series of write-offs. There are a number of coming forward, obviously, related to the discharge of debt, and that's going to be reported to cabinet. Recovery of council tax, the next one now. The performance again improved generally revenue time and will improve again in March. It will probably still be below, slightly below the target, but it will be closer than it was projected as the
appraisal because I'm waiting until next year. Because there's still people in there, people who've been hanging around on appraisals for over 12 months. So I don't think that's really the picture. Right, what I want to ask you is, some of the reds, when you look at the targets and the actual, they're not that dissimilar. And yet, say if you take on page 34, the recovery of council tax and amber, which the target's 82.4 and the actual was 81.5. And then you've got another one that managed to end up with a green, with a red, that's got a similar sort of actual target. So is it pretty close to get to gain a red from an amber?
Very tight. It is very tight. In terms of the criteria to plus or minus 5% or 4%, it depends how it's performing in the reviews as well. In terms of those, they're cumulative. In terms of that's a cumulative one anyway. So it's based on how we get on to the ground for a few years. It's not sort of, some of them are on track to deliver it at 90% per month. Central council tax is cumulative. So that's also factored in when we do the assessment of whether it's had or not.
Just a couple of quick ones. The first one is on page 33, the bottom one about the local supplies in the Thames Valley. When I'm driving here, I find out again there's something wrong with the measure of distance. Secondly, just on things like the tax and the final one of the grants that we can achieve, they are only making very small percentages out. What's that in terms of cash?
First of all, first, the SME suppliers, I understand there was some flaw in the system that was picking up the SME suppliers. I will ask the transaction centre about how to get on with that one, because they won't review it, how that could be made, how it could be implemented. But they're still working with that job, as I understand, that'll be in place for the next financial year, 16 and 17.
Will we get the end of this year?
But then they haven't been paused until the year because of the legal supplier will take it because the basis for it. In terms of council tax percentages, perhaps picking up the one on the grant claim one, the housing benefit claim is in excess of £170 million a year. In terms of the element related to potential loss of that, obviously 0.1% is a significant thing. But the critical element with that one is the number of claims that could be caused by error. Because it's a trigger threshold, which the government is saying, if you get above, probably exactly, it's around about £400,000 worth of errors, you lose an element of subsidy. If the level of errors increases above 600,000, you lose all the subsidy you would have got on those claims. So it's quite a critical threshold to keep within, and that's part of the housing benefit thresholds. What we say, the claim itself is in excess of £170 million, 0.1% is a significant figure.
So just quickly on that, so if we miss it by
surely we can start, we should know what we should be saving out. But we might be able to identify something that we're not saving money on that we should be. But just a suggestion, I think that would be helpful to know. If we previously slipped on that before, maybe having a target and identifying that in good time might help.
In terms of all the savings, if you look at the list, it's probably in excess of 90 different savings we've had this year. Some of those are broken down to sub targets. So we have a gantt chart of every one. We do monitor on a monthly basis, but essentially we have a gantt chart of every one. There's a big plan for every savings target, and there are lots of them on a monthly basis.
Do you think we should know when it slips? Really, that's the thing. We should be able to identify it if we're on target or just slipping. I think that might help. There's nothing more than that. The only other thing to ask about is the identification of fraud and error. The target is less, and we actually achieve more, which is good news. Just curious, because it talks about identification of fraud and error, could you give me an indication of how much of that is fraud, how much of that is error? Is there a breakdown available?
It's great to see that is now back on track. And my last
which is on page 36. The average number of days to accurately process change and circumstances benefit claims. From the narrative, it indicates that it should be 15 days in line with the national data extracts produced by the Department for Work and Pensions. But the target we've actually set ourselves is 17 days, and I was just wondering why that was. That's the end. Thank you.
I'll take the compliments first on discussion having changed, so I'll certainly pass the thanks back to the staff on that one. In terms of appraisals, I think what we're really the key thing about the appraisal here is it's engaging with the staff on a regular basis to have that one-to-one about how we're performing in relation to the course of the plan, how we fit with the delivery of the course of the plan. So there is an element there of self-assessment anyway. Whenever you go for the appraisal, if you need my own mind, I do feel a board if you want to say these are the topics I want to discuss, these are the issues. So there's a self-assessment goes into it. But the key thing is the manager talking to the staff, the person, the member of staff talking to the manager. So it's a two-way conversation. So that's the important bit of it. So from my perspective, I don't want to talk to my people. I want them to talk to me. I always be open to them.
In my own experience of business, that's normally through like the likes of team briefs and stuff like that, not really looking at the day-to-day work. If somebody's got an issue, their work rate is down, I'd expect to deal with that straight away. I just feel that that's the way most companies are going, and it is like 360 degrees, so they have a chance to feedback as well. Just for consideration, we don't want to take that suggestion, that's right.
Yeah, it's just as part of the revised process, I mean, all staff will have one-to-ones on a regular basis anyway. The performance appraisal, the way we set up, there must be at least one occasion each year that you sit down in the booth with that person to go through the various issues. That doesn't mean you don't have other one-to-ones throughout the year. If issues arise during the year, you don't address them. But once a year, you'll sit down in the quiet room to go through the corporate plan issues, how the person fits in and so on. Which I find quite valuable to actually have the space to do that. But it doesn't mean to say, I don't speak to them for the other 364 days a year. I will speak to them on a regular basis, on one-to-one. So it's 4 weeks, once a year, to sit down and have to spend longer than you would normally on that particular person. But I'm not really coming back to a lot of people.
Yeah, I am. But it's only just to say that the self